Brief introductory conversation, then around the 4.5 minute mark, we start getting into the topic of the day, which is actionable steps that everyone can start utilizing today to improve their health, fitness, and wellness through daily activity. Then around 17.5 minutes, we get into the first of three questions, which is strength versus hypertrophy training, rest periods, and when to change between these two phases. Then we finish up around the 25 and a half minute mark, clarifying the low protein day I discussed briefly in the last episode, and then as well as using supplemental leucine to spike muscle protein synthesis. Hey family, it's Marv, One Rep at a Time Radio. We're back. I believe it's going to be episode 6. Got really good feedback from the last episode back after a long layoff, so thank you to everybody who participated. Thank you for all the feedback and comments. It gets me totally psyched. So I'm going to do a quick update about myself personally real quick before I do that. And then also, like I said, in the timestamp in the intro, if you just want to hop ahead to the questions or today's topic, go ahead. But I know I said the last episode, of course, you know, my old email still works, even though the website's down. Well, now it's not working. So, I guess because I didn't keep the domain hosting active, that the old email is not going to work. So if you want to get a hold of me, just reach out to me at onerepmarv, O-N-E-R-E-P as in Paul, M as in man, A-R-V as in Victor, at yahoo.com, onerepmarv at yahoo.com. But still, everything else still applies. You know, the obviously the social media is still active, Facebook's still active, you can still get the free ebook, but just the old email address does not work anymore. So whoops. But anything other than that, quick update. Still, I've been given the unofficial news that I hinted at, but until it's official, I'm going to keep it to myself, but it's going to be rather big. It is going to be changing the trajectory of my life and what One Rep at a Time is, but more importantly, my life. So I'm really excited. It's a really positive thing, but until I get the official news, I'm going to keep that to myself. Other than that, I kind of talked about last week, I'm slowly getting back into resistance training and working out again after 3 weeks off, or over 3 weeks off. That's going well. I'm focusing with my nutrition on just improving my digestion. I'm not tracking anything right now. If I'm going to be perfectly candid and honest, this is typically where I'd get uncomfortable with my body fat levels in the past, as I'm somebody who's suffered or struggled with body or muscle dysmorphia. So it's been a challenge for me to keep doing what I'm doing, which is find foods that is improving my digestion, ease myself back into the gym. I'm actually doing a splitting up my body. So I haven't done, like, I did an arms only day last week. I haven't done an arms only day in years, because that's just inferior in my opinion, unless you're trying to bring up lagging body parts, which, you know, the majority of your lift should be whole body. Less so, like, I did chest and shoulders today, and I'm gonna go do core and blood flow restriction on my triceps tonight once I'm done recording. Not because I'm trying to run 2 days, it's just I just felt like I was done. I mean, I had some work to do. But I'm splitting the body up, you know, with chest and shoulders, back and trap. I did an arms only day. I'm not going to do that this week. And then legs, and then doing some core mobility and in my corrective exercise, easing myself back. So that's been fun. I haven't split up the body in a long time. Again, I think for the average person, whole body lifting is the way to go, or maybe upper lower or pull push, or I just think frequency of how often you're training a muscle is something that's forgotten. You know, you can hit a muscle 5 days a week if you know how to moderate and modulate your intensity and your workload and your volume. I think that's far superior, you know, especially when we're natural drug-free athletes. So anyways, that's me for my nutrition. Again, I'm not tracking anything. I think I will start tracking maybe in the next couple days, but I'm just focusing on getting good digestion, getting my sleep back, getting joint pain down. And it's been fun. It's been different because I'm somebody who typically tracks everything I eat. I don't think it's neurotic. A lot of people say, oh, it is. But I just find that I will either overeat or undereat. I'm not consistent one way or another. So it just gives me an idea. And I just track as I go. I don't have like a set game plan. I'm trying to come up with a set game plan. So I've been eating the same type of food rotations. So playing around with some ideas I have. And so far, it's going so well. I think that's all I got for my update. So let's get into the topics. And if people don't like the updates at all, just let me know and I can keep my mouth shut and just go from there. So I want to give everybody an actionable step, because I know last week or last episode was an amazing Q&A. So again, thank you to everybody. Really good feedback. But it's really like I'm already into fitness. I'm already working out heavy, and it's not for like a beginner. So this topic or this tip I want to talk about, it could be applied to anybody. I don't care if you're a hardcore weightlifter, strongman, powerlifter. You're religious. You go to the gym 6-7 days a week. You're a competitor. I don't care if you only do yoga or Pilates. I don't care if you only go for hikes or play softball. I don't care if you don't exercise at all. This is an actionable step or actionable topic that you can start implementing today. It's going to improve your health and fitness, your quality of life, and your overall wellness and longevity. I will say, obviously, I'm going to be biased, but I definitely think that addressing our physical health is something that is mandatory, especially in the context of today's society where we're overfed and undermoved. Even if you are in addiction recovery, which I am, you know, the slogan is fitness to recovery mindset and make a direct personal amends to yourself through health and fitness. But even if you're not in addiction recovery, you still owe yourself a direct personal amends, whether it be for letting yourself go, whether it be for not being nice to yourself, talking down to yourself, for not taking a chance on a job opportunity or a passion project you wish you did, or whatever, you know, whatever regret you have, make a direct personal amends. And I don't know about you guys, but when I feel good physically, I'm much more mentally sharper, makes me more emotionally stable, and ultimately spiritually fitter. So addressing your health and wellness, I think, is just something really good for a well-rounded life. And it is a form of self-care and direct personal amends. Now, what can this tip be? Because it's got to be, like I said, it could be somebody who doesn't work out at all. They're even thinking about it. It's merely, and there's a variety of ways to do this. We're going to talk about a bunch of stuff, starting from the most basic to a little bit more advanced for somebody who's already working out rather consistently. It's merely increasing your daily activity. Now, why is that so important? Studies have shown that even if you're somebody who does go to the gym for an hour and kills yourself, I mean, balls of the wall intensity, that beast mode nonsense that's preached in the fitness industry right now, or has been preached for a long time, kill yourself in the gym. But you sit around the remaining 23 hours of the day, guess what? You're still at all the health risk for being completely sedentary 24 hours a day. An hour a day is merely not enough. Now, you might have built muscle, you might have lost fat based on your nutrition, but for your overall health and wellness and longevity, still at all the health risks. You know, now they're saying, oh man, sitting down for like 6 or 8 hours, can't remember what it is the equivalent of smoking a whole pack of cigarettes today or whatever clickbait material they're doing for the studies. But not getting movement makes a major negative, has major negative consequences for our health and wellness and longevity. So we want daily activity. Now, doing these tips are not going to make you turn into build muscle and lose fat. You might lose a little bit of body fat, but and we're not talking about like the aesthetics or the physique side of things, because health and wellness is not merely your physique. And guess what? When you're healthy, you typically look good or look well. Health looks great. So if we improve your health and wellness, yes, there might be some trickle down effects, but no, this is not going to turn you into a bodybuilder, but it is going to improve your life quality. Is get your daily activity in. And one of my favorite ways, we talked about it in the free ebook that you could still get on our Facebook page, is track your steps. Slowly increase your step. Whether it be a Fitbit, actually got one for Christmas and I've been blown away by how many steps I do. For instance, today, without even making an effort, 14,519 steps and it's only 7:30. So I did more steps than I was aware of, which is an awesome problem to have. But increase your steps slowly over time, whether it be a step counter on your phone, an Apple Watch, a Fitbit, a Body Bug, whatever. I'm sure I'm missing one or two different companies or products out there, but track your steps. It is unbelievable to me, but it's just the context of modern life, how few people even get 4,000 steps. I believe 4,000 steps is only a half hour of walking. You walk less than half hour in an entire 24-hour period. So what we would do is slowly and gradually increase your steps. This works for the average person. This works for competitors. Instead of having to do cardio, we increase your steps. If you're having to walk 20,000 steps in a given day right before you step on stage, now you might have to hop on a cardio machine, but getting steps throughout the day is going to be more effective anyways, because they've also done studies where an hour-long cardio session on a treadmill is far surpassed by if you split that hour up into 3 20-minute sessions. So daily activity throughout the day is more impactful. So how do you increase your steps? And like, let's just say real quickly, you say you average 4,000 steps. How quickly you want to ratchet it up is entirely up to you. I do this based on what's realistic. After I've talked with somebody, you know, I get a kind of a sense for their personality and what they're going to be adhered to. You could ramp it up just 500 steps a week. I mean, 500 steps a day every week. You can ramp it up 1,000 steps every day every week. And obviously you have like a set date for you want to have a certain day you just want to look your best. You might need to ramp them up 2,000 steps every week, but every week to week, increase your daily step total. You could do that by taking stairs. I think taking stairs is fantastic. Park at the far end of parking lots. Don't sit on your phone hunched over at work during your lunch period. Walk around. Instead of just sitting there talking on your phone, pace in your apartment or your house, wherever you live, while talking on the phone, things like that. If you have dogs and animals, obviously take them for a walk, play with your kids or grandchildren. Find little ways and little hacks to walk around. If work allows and you get a work break, don't just sit at your desk, walk the office. Do something where you're getting daily activity in. Do something where you're getting your steps in, you're slowly increasing them and you can track them. One of the best ways to increase your steps, and we've talked about this, I've talked about this in every time I've been a guest interviewer on a podcast, talked about this in our books, talked about this on our YouTube, on our Instagram, on our Facebook. Go for a 5 to 10 minute walk after every major meal. That is your actionable step, folks. 5 to 10 minutes. If you have kids or grandchildren, it is a fantastic way to turn into a family tradition. If you have a significant other, me and my girl did this tonight. We had a really heavy, in-depth conversation because there's going to be a lot of changes for us. Went on a walk after we ate. Fantastic. It'll strengthen the relationship. If you don't have a significant other, go for a walk and make a phone call and talk to somebody. If you have a roommate, go with your roommate. Go listen to some uplifting speeches or podcasts or classical music or whatever. Or just go to unplug and get out of the rat race of, you know, constant stimulation from all the electronics we have, you know, all that good stuff, or bad, depending on how you use it. Do that 5 to 10 minutes, and this will actually improve your digestion and improve your insulin sensitivity. So when we're walking, you're letting gravity do its job. It's going to improve your digestion. Also, the gait pattern of your bones in your legs will actually massage your GI tract, which is going to improve your digestion. And they've shown that going for a 5 to 10 minute walk after meals actually reduces the amount of insulin your body releases in response to the meal. That's going to improve your insulin sensitivity. Insulin resistance is an epidemic, you know, diabetes, pre-diabetes. Now folks are calling Alzheimer's type 3 diabetes. So improving your insulin sensitivity, reducing the amount of insulin your body is having to pump out to every meal is going to improve your insulin sensitivity. It's going to reduce your overall inflammation. And inflammation is basically the underlying root cause to almost all disease. So going for a walk is fantastic. You know, my walks take about 15 minutes. And yes, I did a quick workout downstairs like I talked about. And I went for 3 walks today. And like I said, I'm already at, 14,000, 15,000 steps. So And I'm going to eat again, and I'm going to go for a walk again. Now, I do know that not everybody lives where I live. I live in Southern California, so I could pretty much walk outside almost year-round. I also have a stationary bike. I hop on the bike sometimes if I don't want to go for a walk. Now, going for a walk outside is going to have some benefits. Get outside in the sunlight based on where you live. Get vitamin D. So for most folks, you can convert sunlight to vitamin D. Not everybody. There is like a genetic defect, I guess, for lack of a better word, for folks who do not convert sunlight to vitamin D. But most folks do. It's getting out in the fresh air. It can get you out of this nasty artificial blue light that wreaks havoc on our sleep systems and wreaks havoc on your eyes, on your melatonin production or secretion. You can mess with your sleep. So big benefits for that. Now, what if you can't go outside for a walk? Walk indoors. Even if you have to just pace your house or your apartment or walk laps in the office building where you work, do it. So that's your actionable step. Now, what else? Post-it notes and Sharpies. That's a topic I love. Go Sharpie first. I haven't done it lately. I need to do it again. But whenever I write an S on my hand, it signifies every time I use the restroom, I need to do 10 air squats. So I do this about half of the time. I'm still not perfect adherence, but I'm getting there. And guess what? I've never had anybody have the courage to ask why the hell I'm squatting at a urinal in a public restroom. Guys might laugh and be like, hell yeah, but they've never asked me, why are you squatting? And you could come up with anything. Remember, everything I talk about right now is just ideas. Post-it notes. I like having people put post-it notes around their house, around their office, depending on where they work. Put a post-it on the fridge. Every time you open the fridge, 5 to 10 jumping jacks. Every time you brush your teeth, 10 lunges. Every time you turn on your computer, 10 squats or push-ups or whatever. Obviously, tailor it to your fitness abilities and goals and make sure you know how to body weight squat correctly before you start squatting all the time. And you could tell, it could even be one squat. I don't care. Start somewhere and build your way up. So I love post-it notes. Okay, you could add to that list or that idea, almost ad infinitum. Set a timer at work. Whenever I have folks who spend most of their day in a cubicle, they have a timer. When that goes off, they got to do some sort of activity. It might be just walk to the water cooler and back, do some air squats, do some lunges. And what's cool is when you do these things, your productivity is going to go up through the roof. I know it doesn't make sense. Well, I'm taking time away from work. You're getting oxygen in. You're going from your right it's either right brain, your left brain, or left brain, your right brain. Paul Check talks about this. Switching it, my creativity goes up. When I would do a lot of writing or researching stuff or writing protocols or programs or whatever, and I start to get, like a mental fog, I do 10 air squats, 10 push-ups, 10 jumping jacks, boom, locked and loaded. It's the best cup of coffee you ever had. So really increases your productivity at work. So, set a timer. If you feel your eyes glazing over when you're working on a project, do that. I guarantee it'll increase your productivity. Pretty amazing. And then to finish up with people who are already lifting consistently, or maybe not consistently, but you want to increase the amount of times you're doing, movements, doing resistance bands or body weight movements 2 to 3 times a day. Now, what you would do with resistance band is you pick a movement for body parts. Let's just say bare bones basic. You would do 20 to 30 reps of a banded row, 20 to 30 reps of a banded chest press, and 20 to 30 reps of a air squat. Do that 2 to 3 times a day. One, you're practicing the movements. Two, you're getting a nice little pump in the muscle. You might be shocked with this, how it helps you lean out or maybe build more muscle, get better pumps overall. You get better practice at a squat or a lunge. Again, it wakes you up, increases your daily activity. So if you don't get to lift heavy weights that day, if you're somebody who does, at least did some sort of activity and enhances recovery. So I call them recovery sessions. So those are fantastic based on where you are. If it's not feasible for everybody, but say you want to get better at pull-ups or a bigger back, put a pull-up bar somewhere in your house. And every time you walk by, whether it be in the bathroom or just like spare guest room in a house, every time you walk by, you got to do 1 to 5 pull-ups. Guarantee you're gonna get better at pull-ups, you're gonna get stronger at pull-ups, you're gonna get a bigger back. I did this a lot when I had guys who I trained getting ready for military boot camp or special forces. Certain benchmarks I need to set, and one guy came to me just the low 20s for push-ups. By the end, he was doing sets of 80. And I had another guy, same type of idea. Or improve grip strength, put a towel from the pull-up bar. So you have to grip the towel to pull yourself up. Man, talk about improving your grip strength. Phenomenal. I love doing that for Spartan race people or like Tough Mudders or whatever. So that's more advanced. Now, you never go to failure during this, but constant daily activity and stimulation is massively important. That's why we walk on 2 feet. We're designed to be active throughout the day. So increase your daily activity. And what was the actionable step I said? Obviously, hopefully you can incorporate all of these, but the one I want everybody to do starting right now, 5 to 10 minutes after every meal, go for a walk. You're lucky enough to have an elliptical or a stationary bike in your room, in your house. Just hop on that if you can't go outside or if it's super late. I guarantee you that's going to improve your quality of health, your longevity, your wellness, and you're making that direct personal amends. And it's setting the tone that, yes, I am working on my physical health. Even if I can't get a workout in a day, I'm not completely neglecting it. I'm not going to take 5 steps backwards. If anything, I might even step 4 because I'm improving my recovery. I'm improving my digestion. I'm getting my daily activity up, increasing the amount of calories I'm expending throughout the given day. I'm improving my insulin sensitivity. Do that, and I promise it's going to pay off for you in the long run. So now that we talked about that, I have one's like a two-part question following up to the last episode, and then another one about strength training versus hypertrophy training, rest periods, and when to switch between. Let's talk about that one first, and we'll end with the low protein day that I glossed over, and then a follow-up question about using supplemental leucine to enhance muscle protein synthesis. So strength training versus hypertrophy training, rest periods, and when to switch it up. Let's talk about some terms. Obviously, this is going to be weightlifting specific, everybody. Strength training is typically thought of as heavyweight, low reps. Typically, you rest anywhere. The recommended is like 3 to 5 minutes. Personally, I say rest about 2 to 3. When I program in strength phases for clients or work with people, it's 2 to 3. There's not much of a difference between 3 to 4 minutes, but there is a difference between 2 to 3 minutes. So resting 3 minutes between your heavy sets of squats and deadlifts and rows and overhead presses and bench presses, totally fine. What's hypertrophy? Hypertrophy means muscle growth. Essentially, that's your typical bodybuilder stuff. So if the traditional rule of thought is strength training is your 1 to 5 rep range. Hypertrophy training is your 8 to 12 rep range. And then quote unquote toning is your 15 to 18 rep range. Now, I'm here to tell you right now, every single rep range is muscle building. You could build muscle in the 1 to 5 rep range. You could build muscle in the 5 to 8 rep range. You could build muscle in the 8 to 12, the 15 to 20. Hell, you could build muscle in the 20 to 30 rep range. I promise you, if you start doing 20 rep squats with a weight that is damn near it's possible. It's really, really hard to get those 20 reps in with good form. Your legs are going to blow up. I love to do that, but guess what? I have not been able to do high rep squats in at least 4 months because my quads got so big, I can't fit into half of the damn pants in my closet. Quality problems, I know, right? But with my waist and with my leg size, I can't fit into half of the pants. I kept ripping them when I was wearing them. Got old really quick. So while I love it, I've actually had to back off of that. So don't think, everybody goes, oh, to build muscle, you've got to train in the 8 to 12 rep range. That's all you need to do. No, Now, pro bodybuilders do that, and they can progress year in and year out. Well, we've all kind of gotten smart as to why. So that's why they can stay in a rep range. But yes, this guy asks the correct question. You do want to switch them up. Now, what about rest periods for your traditional hypertrophy training? It's typically recommended 1 to 2 minutes, 60 to 90 seconds. Guess what? I could do a whole other topic on rest periods. Rest periods is a variable of workouts that a lot of people don't mess with, and we typically gravitate towards the same rest period. I gravitate towards a shorter rest period. Because when I was younger, remember, I read bodybuilding magazines, aka Muscle Comics, and my rest periods are always shorter because I would superset everything and I would try and do what they did. So me taking these 3 minute rest periods is a chore. Like, I have a stopwatch that I will use when I really want to be locked in and monitoring everything. I use a stopwatch. So absolutely use a stopwatch. If you've never paid attention to how long your rest periods are, if you start paying attention, like, you're going to find you typically gravitate towards the same rest period. And guess what? Whenever I program in rest periods, are for a reason. Side pokes go, well, I'm ready to go. No, I want you to rest periods talk about energy systems. They talk about recovery. So there's a rhyme and a reason for them. Strength training, yes. When you're doing heavy 1 to 5 rep training, 1 to 3 rep training, I want you resting 3 minutes between compound lifts. So your squat, your overhead press, your bench, your row, your deadlift. If you're doing heavy strength training isolation movements, which, yeah, I don't think doing, you know, 2 rep curls makes much sense to me personally. When I do strength training for folks, their curls are in the 6 to 8 rep range if they've already earned the right to do curls. If not, guess what? Doing weighted chin-ups is going to build your biceps way more than curls. But anyways, 2 to 3. I don't think we should ever be going crazy heavy on short rest periods. But say you go into the hypertrophy rep range, 8 to 12. Start out a 2 minute rest period and then work your way down to a 90 second, then a 60 second, then a 30 second. Man, if you go all the way down to 30-second rest periods, holy cow, it is amazing. It's very, very difficult. It's your ego has to be checked. So one thing I love to do is I call it the 15-12-8 method. We have the same weight for the exercise for all 3 sets. You only get 30 seconds. Now, I don't start people at 30 seconds. We gradually reduce the rest periods. If you go from a 3-minute rest period to now you're only going to do 30 seconds, you're probably going to puke. You're going to be dying. So I go 15 reps, set 1 with the same weight, rest 30 seconds. 12 reps, set 2 with the same weight, rest 30 seconds. 8 reps, set 3 with the same weight, rest 30 seconds. Typically, that's where folks fall. Now, if you could do more than that, then by all means. But if you're pushing yourself and you have the right weight selected, 15-12-8 is a really good benchmark and something to shoot for. Now, when to switch. Every 3 to 8 weeks, switch your workouts. Unless you're like a power lifter, then you have a meet, then yes, you have a specific protocol that's mapped out before time, ahead of time, I mean, with different percentages. But for the average person, 3 to 8 weeks, when I program it in, 3 to 8 weeks, we tend to, like I talked about with rest periods, get stuck in a phase that we really like. So my physique muscle building people, they tend to get stuck in the 8 to 12 rep range. My strength people, my power lifters, tend to get stuck in the 1 to 5 rep range. Switch it up. Do what you're not good at and watch how much you're going to change. So 3 to 8 weeks. Why I do that is first week you're feeling it out. Second week you kind of know what weights you're going to use if you take the workout log. Third week you could really push the envelope. Now, after 8 weeks, you still might be progressing some, but the rate of progression is slowed down. So let's just say I'm just throwing out arbitrary numbers. Weeks 1, 2, and 3, you're improving by 20% week in to week out. Now, by week 8, you might be improving 2%. You're still improving, but you're not at 20%. If I would change the workout phase, that rate of improvement goes right back up to 20 again. Again, arbitrary numbers, but you think you get my point. So I don't like to get stuck in a workout phase for too long. Now, if a workout phase is working fantastic, then ride it out. But I think 2 months is the max. Switch it up. Even if you still think you're feeling great, I promise you changing it will help. And you could change things like exercises. You could change things like rest periods. You could change things like the loads you're using or advanced. If do you superset? Do you do straight sets? Do you do advanced techniques? For the average person, I just think straight sets is the way to go. If you want to superset arms, that's fine. But switch up your workout phases every 3 to 8 weeks. Change your rest periods. I like to change the rest periods with the workout phases personally, but absolutely play around with it. I mean, you could take the same workout. And if say you just find that you've averaged a 2.5 minute rest, if you go down to a 1 minute rest, it is a big time difference. If you go down, work your way down to a 30 second rest, it is another big difference. Your body will change. If you change the stimulus, your body's going to be forced to change. Now, when you shorten the rest period, just be aware that you need to be hyper focused and cognizant of your form. The loads are going to be, you're not going to be as much time to recover in between. So it's going to feel heavy. You might need to reduce the amount of weight on the bar or the reps might need to go down. That's why I like that 15-12-8 method personally. When you're doing 1 to 5 reps, keep the little rest periods long. Again, do whatever sounds terrible to you is probably what you need to do. Does that make sense? So all my super bendy yoga people would probably benefit from doing some strength training. All my CrossFit people would probably benefit from strength training. Conversely, all my powerlifters would really benefit from going in higher rep range. So do what you're not doing and you're going to get a great result, right? Our bodies like us hate to change. And so we like to do what we're good at, change up, go to something you're not good at, and you're going to be forced to get better and just watch the improvements that come.
A short interruption, family. Are you looking for a custom workout routine? Help with your nutrition planning? Maybe you need some online training, looking for a fitness and health consultation, you name it. Go to our social media at @onerepatatime_ or our Facebook at @onerepatatime. Shoot us a DM for more information. Hope your family's liking the episode. Really be appreciative if you share us with your friends and family, loved ones. Now let's get back to One Rep at a Time Radio.
All right. Now we're going to finish up on a doozy of a two-parter question. Person asked about, because I gloss over low protein days for building muscle, which I know doesn't make sense on paper. Then they asked a follow-up question about using leucine to trigger muscle protein synthesis, or I'm going to call it MPS, because me saying muscle protein synthesis really fast, it makes it sound like I have a lisp, but I don't know what I'm saying. So I'm going to say MPS for short. I'm going to try and be as short and concise as possible because I can get really nitty-gritty because I love the science of it, but a lot of folks don't want to know every little thing. So to sum it up, let's take a step back. What is muscle protein synthesis, MPS? Exactly what it sounds like. Essentially, it's like you're building something in your body. So you're either anabolic building or you're catabolic breaking down. It's never an on-off switch. It's never 100% one way or 100% the other way. It's variation in degrees. Your body's constantly building and tearing itself down. That's the circle of life. So the idea is if you trigger MPS more, you're going to build more muscle. Now, that is true to a certain extent. Now, how to trigger MPS, there's things you could do in low protein days, believe it or not, will enhance your body's ability to trigger MPS down the road. Now, leucine, what is leucine? Leucine is an amino acid. Amino acids are the building blocks of protein. There's 20 amino acids. You have your essential, which your body cannot manufacture, and your non-essential, which your body can manufacture. Leucine is cool. Your body is cool. If you didn't know it, your body's flipping cool. It's brilliant. When we trigger MPS in the body, it's either through your exercise, so your resistance training, or it's through your diet with eating protein. And if you blend the two together, then that's how you build more muscle. Because you could trigger MPS through your eating, but only to a certain extent. When you blend the resistance training with the increased protein intake, that's like the magical 1-2 punch where the 1+1=3 effect. So to trigger MPS, it means that you need to have enough of all the amino acids in present that are the building blocks. So our body has singled out leucine as the amino acid that it will monitor the blood plasma levels of. When you that leucine level in your bloodstream starts to go up, it hits a certain threshold, it triggers MPS. Okay, instead of having to pay attention to all the amino acids, it's singled out leucine because it is one of the main, what's known as a branch chain amino acid. BCAAs, they're really big in the supplement industry. Full disclosure, I have consumed, I'm not kidding you, family, I've probably consumed over 100 pounds of BCAAs. Oh, I want my fucking money back. So anyways, so the idea is if I consume leucine or branched chain amino acids, I will trigger muscle protein synthesis constantly, especially if I sip on it throughout the day, if I take it with meals, if I take it between meals, it's going to be awesome. I'm going to be super anabolic because the latest, greatest bodybuilder told me he does that, or he sips on a gallon of milk all day. You know, again, I can't tell you how many jack, huge mass monster guys are sipping on milk all day long, and they say, oh, I have a constant supply of amino acids in my bloodstream to help me grow. No, that's not how it works. They're growing, absolutely, but we know why they're growing. Now, they still have to put in a lot of hard work, so I don't want to make it sound like I'm totally bashing, but let's just be realistic now. Leucine's really cool, but guess what? Our body has a system of checks and balances. So yes, while it monitors leucine to trigger the switch for MPS, if you don't have the other amino acids present, you don't have the building blocks. So taking in only leucine by itself is not going to do much. That's why I'm not a fan of branched-chain amino acids. Let me knock this out real quick. The only time branched-chain amino acids or supplemental leucine can help is in two two situations. One, you're an endurance athlete because branching amino acids attach to the same receptors in the brain that tryptophan does, which makes you feel tired and fatigued. You know, tryptophan that everybody says turkey has a bunch of, and that makes you fall asleep after Thanksgiving dinner. Turkey doesn't have like unnaturally high levels of tryptophan compared to other animal meats. It's just all the over gorging and stuffing and carbohydrates and sugars that you eat that cause you to pass out, not the tryptophan from the turkey. But anyways, taking branched amino acids during endurance activities, 100% I'm behind. If you're somebody who chronically underconsumes protein, 100%, it could help offset the low levels of amino acids you're taking in, and it can trigger muscle protein synthesis as long as you're getting some protein in, 100%. Outside of that, save your money. It is a waste of flipping time, and I know that goes against everything you've ever read or what the fitness and supplement industry tells you, and trust me, I fell for the trick, so I'm trying to parlay this to you. You know, I'm not kidding. Over 100 pounds. Might even be 200. So I fell for it. I don't use it now. How we trigger MPS is not a consistent stream of amino acids. That's where these, you know, that's where I was getting kind of irritated when people say, sip on branching amino acids throughout the day. Doing so can mess with your neurotransmitters and actually cause depression. Yeah. Not good. Constantly drinking milk throughout the day, eating every hour, getting protein in every hour. No, we need what's known as large bolus doses. B-O-L-U-S, this means a large dose, where we trigger muscle protein synthesis. We get over a certain threshold, which on average is 3 grams of leucine. Now, on average, for every 10 grams of protein, there's 1 gram of leucine. So I recommend folks get in at least 30 grams of protein per meal.
And we're getting these meals or servings of protein in at least 3, if not 4 hours apart from each other, for the most part, based on your schedule. Now, research also shows, as far as maximizing MPS, sure, there is going to be a difference between getting in 3, 4, maybe 5, you know, servings of protein per day, as opposed to just 1 or 2.
Okay, it's a system of checks and balances. I was in the book I wrote about nutrition. You think I would know off the top of my head? It's either after 2 or 3 hours, don't quote me, it's either 2 or 3, it's one or the other. Even if you have elevated levels of amino acids in your bloodstream, including leucine, muscle protein synthesis returns back to normal, turns back to baseline. So we want these large individual feedings of protein throughout the day to trigger it. Taking in branching amino acids 2 hours after your meal, well, MPS is returning back to baseline, and we want it to detect, you know, the amino acid levels dropping and then spiking and dropping. That is the best way to trigger muscle protein synthesis consistently. Now, where does low protein days come into it? Studies have also shown, if you chronically overconsume protein, just like anything else, our body desensitizes to it. So instead of using protein for what it's for, which is to build and repair, it starts to use it almost like a fuel source, like protein and carbohydrates. Typically, our body runs off of carbohydrates and fats for a fuel source. If we chronically overconsume protein, our body starts to use it for energy, starts to use protein as a fuel source. We don't want that. We want protein to be used to rebuild and repair the body. So low protein days come into, if you're somebody who's overconsumed protein, your body resensitizes to it. Taking a break from anything, taking a break from caffeine, from working out, from whatever, like taking a break resensitizes our body to it. By doing a low protein day, you're going to resensitize to the amino acids from protein. You're going to be more anabolic. So I know it doesn't make any sense on paper, but you'll build more muscle in the long run. I incorporated this into majority of my clients. It also depends on your history. If you're like me, you might have eaten enough protein to feed a small village. That's what I did because I got all my information out of Muscle Comics. I'm pounding shakes. I'm pounding protein bars. I'm freaking out. I'm going catabolic every 3 hours. No. So I have overconsumed protein. So by doing low protein days, my digestion gets better. My performance gets better. I swear I get bigger pumps in the gym when I work out. Now, what do you do on the low protein days? No direct forms of protein. You essentially have a vegetarian day. You can eat nuts, veg, fruit, healthy fats. Now, you can combine this with fasting if fasting is appropriate for you. If it's not, then don't fast. I like to do fasting. I fast for 24 hours at night. I have a big meal, a big ass, like 2 pound bowl of vegetables and a little bit of nuts and healthy fats. The next morning, I only have vegetables and then I consume protein and then I work out. My pumps are always insane. My performance is always through the roof. I feel fantastic. So that's where I incorporate low protein days. You can do anywhere from 1 to 4 times a month. Now, if you're quote unquote bulking, you're trying to build muscle, I'm a huge fan of at least once a week. If you're in a caloric deficit, trying to lose body fat, based on your history, it's going to be depending on, based on your calories, you're depending on. But even then, I still like to do at least 1 a month, if not 2. So maybe 1 every 2 weeks. Resensitize yourself to protein, right? Carb cycling is preached and accepted in the fitness world. Protein cycling is not. Food choice cycling is not. That's another topic for another day. But low protein days will help you build more muscle in the long run. You could do a low calorie day, or you could just eat, you know, 3, 4, 5 potatoes or yams, a bunch of starchy carbohydrates, fill up your stored carbohydrate stores in your muscle known as glycogen, and just watch how much better you'll perform. Your pumps will be fantastic. It's going to be phenomenal. So that's how you could use low protein days to build more muscle. Leucine, if you are under consuming protein, then yes. And how I would use leucine in that case is, say you're just a low protein person. You're not going to change, which is fine.
This is really common with folks following a plant-based diet. And if that's what you want to do, you feel good on it, you have your moral reasons, by all means, continue doing so.
On meals, when you take a meal in, just take in some leucine or branched chain amino acids. You don't need to be crazy. Now, one more thing. I know people have a question, what should be your total for protein? I typically shoot for the 1.0 to 1.2 grams per pound of body weight based on your goals. Now, if you're overweight, we do significantly less than that. But 1.0 to 1.2, I kind of typically gravitate a little bit higher than that because I love to eat protein, not shakes, but real food. So today, meal one was 5 eggs. Meal two was a pound of turkey, ground turkey. Meal three was a pound of ribeye. And I'm going to probably eat 1/2 pound of snapper for second dinner, quote unquote, for my fourth meal today. I love to consume protein. So that's going to be more than 1.0 gram per pound of body weight. So on days I do low protein, I try and go as low as possible. I try to get under 40 grams, and that's just residual from maybe some nuts and some veg, but no direct sources of protein, and you're good to go. So that's how you would incorporate that. So I hope that clears the air. I know the leucine conversation can get really in depth and nitty gritty and blah, but for the most part, save your money on leucine. And that concludes our episode. So again, if you have anything you ever want me to cover, don't wait for me to post the Q&A thing on Instagram and social media and Facebook. Go ahead and shoot me an email or contact me wherever you found us. I could just get a list compiled together to keep putting out content. If you have any pointers or feedback, absolutely let me know, because I'm trying to get back into the swing of things. If I got a little bit too science heavy in the leucine conversation, let me know, and I would greatly appreciate that. Remember, we can do anything we want. One day at a time, one meal at a time, one set at a time, one rep at a time. Marv, one rep at a time. Radio family, see you soon.